Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. Have hopefully you had a great weekend. We are on another session of our Everything Parkinson's webinar. Welcome to Everything Parkinson's. Today, we have a special guest who is really, you've seen her here several times in our webinar, so she's really a familiar face to our webinar. We do have Dr. Natalie Diaz. As you know, she is our movement disorder neurologist in our Torrance location, and she has given us numerous talks in the past that really helps and guides us through our journey with Parkinson's disease. If you receive our webinar emails, we did put an addition. You will know now what our next session will be. So next month we will be discussing it was more behavioral issues, and this is going to be with Dr. Petrosian. So that's going to be for July. So without further ado, please help me welcome our dear movement disorder neurologist, Dr. Natalie Diaz.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. So I'm going to be talking today about complementary therapies in Parkinson's disease. And it's possible I gave this talk a few months ago for the Parkinson's Foundation. They had asked me to talk about this. And I believe it's maybe even been on our website for PNI website, maybe for a month or two as well. So it's very possible that some of you on today's call may have already heard this talk. I changed it around a little bit, but it may be that I'm, repeating things that you've already heard. For those of you who are joining us today who have not heard this talk, I'm going to talk a little bit about what complementary therapies are, what we know about them, what people should be careful with. And I'll start with a disclaimer in that I am not an expert in complementary therapies. For those of you that come to see me in my clinic in Torrance or have seen me on this program, I am a clinician. I'm a neurologist, a movement disorder specialist. I spend most of my time in clinic seeing patients. I do research in pharmaceutical trials, trying to bring new medications to market, but I have not worked or done research specifically with complementary therapies. So my knowledge on this topic just comes from my day-to-day working with patients and this growing trend and interest in complementary therapies. So my goals for today are to discuss, well, what do we mean by complementary therapies? How are they defined? What are the different types of complementary therapies that are out there? I'm going to talk a little bit about what I call the good, the bad, and the ugly about them, sort of give you a well-rounded view about what we know, what we don't know, and unfortunately what some of the bad issues are with it, and how to be an informed consumer, how to know where to go to learn about some of these therapies, what are the benefits that you could look for, but also what some of the precautions in taking these before you take them. So let's start with some terms and definitions. So we think of complementary therapies, or they're defined by the National Institute of Health as products and practices that are non-FDA approved, not prescribed by a physician, natural practices or products that are taken alongside conventional medicine. So they're there to complement therapy that your practitioner, physician, or advanced care practitioner prescribes, and you take them along with it. This is different from the term alternative therapies, where people see these kind of practices or products as an alternate instead of traditional medicine or conventional medicine. And as physicians, we never recommend that people forgo treatment if they need it. So, we have a lot of great therapies for Parkinson's disease. They're not perfect medications. We hate to see when people are really suffering or having disability to really be so anti-medication and really look at these as an alternate to traditional or conventional medications. But we do understand that people are looking for other things, and the complementary therapies are some things that can be taken alongside conventional medicines. Now, there's been a growing trend and interest in these products and practices over the last couple decades. It's a big business. I mean, there's a lot of promise out there. And so medicine has been trying to catch up with this, and the medical field has tried to do a little bit more research and learn about this and incorporate it into our medical practice. And there's an area of medicine now that's called integrative medicine. This is a field of medicine where physicians, whether they're specialists or internists, can train and be certified as an integrative medical doctor, where they have the knowledge and the tools about complementary therapies and how to use them for conditions alongside conventional therapies. So this is an interesting and growing area of medicine now, where conventional medical doctors are becoming more comfortable with this practice. So as I mentioned, this is an important topic because this has been a growing trend over the last 20 years or more. We've seen more and more Americans and worldwide people looking to complementary therapies for some relief. A couple of studies that have shown that at least 40 or 50% of people in this country alone use complementary therapies. And we lag a little bit behind worldwide in some cultures in Asia, in Europe, and in Africa. People use these types of therapies and have for longer than us, and is maybe ingrained in some of their cultural practices as well. There's definitely a geographic variation on the use of these. You know, in the US, we tend to focus more on natural products such as vitamins, herbs, and supplements. In Asia, they have traditionally, this is ingrained in their culture, traditional medical systems that incorporate both natural products and some of these practices. They're ingrained in the society. They're much more accessible and lower cost. And in Europe, they tend to gravitate more towards mind and body practices. Now, in this country, this has been growing over the last decade, and we're seeing not only a boom now in vitamins, herbs, and supplements, but in this country also the mind and body practices over the last 20 years has also been growing. Interestingly, there are studies that have shown that women tend to be bigger consumers of these products, especially the mind and body practices like yoga, massage, and acupuncture. And it also tends to go along socioeconomic lines. So the higher the income level, there seems to be a higher interest in some of these practices. And this is a big business. There are studies that have shown that, you know, by the 2028, this is going to be a business that makes hundreds of billions of dollars in consumer spending in this country alone. So this has become now a big business in the use of complementary and alternative therapies. Despite this growing trend, there are studies that have shown that more than half of Americans that are taking these products don't discuss them with their doctors for whatever reason, that they don't feel comfortable or whatever. But a lot of patients are taking these, and unless they're asked, don't willingly tell their doctors what they're taking. So it's an important point because, as I'll talk about in today's lecture, there can be interactions with what people are taking and some of these complementary therapies, especially natural products. And there can also be interactions between complementary products themselves. So it's very important that whoever is on your treating team, doctors, physicians, physical therapists, they know that that you are, you know, what exactly you're being exposed to, both from a supplement as well as from different practices. Now, the medical industry, the conventional medical industry, has actually been trying to catch up. And there are studies that have been showing that, you know, larger hospital systems and academic centers are now offering, because of patient-driven demand, are now offering more of these services to patients. So, you know, yoga, mindfulness, tai chi, massage. So more of these services now are becoming mainstream in larger institutions and subspecialty institutions. In terms of individual physicians, it's kind of hit or miss. It's still kind of a growing idea. Some, you know, doctors outside of those that are integratively trained in as I mentioned, in integrative medicine, some doctors feel comfortable with this discussion. Other doctors will easily say, you know, I don't know. Let's look it in together. Let's discuss it. That's what I do. My patients who know me know that I'm always willing to talk about these topics. And oftentimes I'll say, you know, I don't know. Let me go look it up and we'll have a discussion, or I'll email you what I find. But doctors are becoming more comfortable with it. And of course, there's always doctors that either don't feel comfortable with it, and yet some that don't believe in it at all. But there is a growing trend with doctors becoming more comfortable. There was an interesting study here on the left that was published in 2006. This was at the Mayo Clinic, where they surveyed doctors of all specialties and asked them, you know, what their comfort level was in discussion of these therapies. And about a quarter of doctors said that they talked to their patients about complementary and alternative therapies. About a quarter of doctors said that they talked about any sort of implications or interactions between their medicines and some of the complementary therapies. And those that did have discussions or claimed that they had discussions with their patients, the majority of them said that the conversation started because the patient initiated it. So it goes to show you how important it is that, you know, a lot of doctors maybe are willing to talk about it, but sometimes they may not be comfortable bringing up the topic, or they forget. They're asking you about what medications you're on, and they're going through the list of medications that you're on, but they may not ask you about supplements. We in our office try to be very cognizant when we see our patients, when we go through the medication list at every visit, not only going through their medication list, but what other supplements are you taking, so that we know if there's any interaction. This is another study that was published in 2020, and this is looking at primary care outpatient physicians. And in this one, it shows that more than 50% of doctors are having these conversations with their patients about complementary and alternative therapies. Interestingly, it tends to be more female doctors than males. But there is this, it does show that there is a growing trend amongst community physicians to have these discussions. And why do people seek these therapies? Well, there can be a lot of different reasons. I think in this country, what the studies have shown is that patients are looking for benefit. They're looking for something that makes them feel better, that makes them help with their symptoms. And maybe they are dissatisfied with what they're getting from their traditional or conventional medications, or they're having side effects with their conventional medications. And I get it. I think most neurologists and those that treat Parkinson's disease, if we think about it, can understand that. You know, we don't have a cure for Parkinson's as of yet. We know that these medications are imperfect. We have a whole arsenal of medications that we have available to treat patients with Parkinson's disease. There's more than 20 medications now FDA approved for Parkinson's disease at different stages. And we use them depending on the symptoms that patients have. And in the beginning, they can be wonderful drugs and really get people moving and keep them working and doing all the things that they need to do. But we know that over the course of the years of Parkinson, over the course of Parkinson's disease, things can change and these medications can lose their effect, or they can last less over time, or have some toxicities. There are symptoms that, you know, don't respond to some of our traditional medications. So we understand that there are gaps and there's dissatisfaction with what we have available from conventional medicine. So I understand why patients look to some of these. But there is also another reason. I think a lot of patients also see them as a sense of control, a sense of empowerment, of doing something for yourself, of making yourself feel better. In other countries, as I mentioned earlier, it's a little bit more mainstream. It's part of the culture. Some of these practices have been used for generations. And so it is something that is easily talked about in both their medical offices, is with family and friends. And so it's much more prevalent in their use than it is in this country. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about what I call the good, the bad, and the ugly about complementary therapies. And there's a little bit of everything here. So, you know, complementary therapies are enticing to people. They tend to, and they're advertised more for general health and wellness versus just treating specific symptoms. We know looking at animal models and in the lab, some of these that have been studied, they get more at the core of some of the things that are happening in the body, whether it's inflammation or it's oxidative stress. They look more at body processes rather than trying to treat individual symptoms. And they also give people a sense of control and empowerment over your own health. You're doing your own research. I'm making the decision as to what I want to do for myself. And, you know, I make the control of what I'm going to take. And I get that. And, you know, again, in some of the studies that have been done in with some of these therapies, they do seem to have some effect in some more general symptoms: sleep, pain, stress, anxiety, constipation. So they tend to be good for some of these non-motor symptoms that can be a big problem in a lot of people with Parkinson's disease. And to be honest, most of these therapies, if taken in modest doses and discussion with your practitioner and understanding the risks and the potential side effects, are relatively low risk. If people understand what they're getting into, if everybody's aware of what you're taking and people want to try these, if you're getting them and sourcing them from reputable sources, most of the therapies that I will talk about today are considered relatively low risk. So most of the time when my patients bring up these topics to me about them, if I know about them, we'll talk about them. What are the pluses? What do we know? What are the potential benefits, the potential risks? Let's hold everything as steady and try it and see how you feel. And I usually, you know, unless I know that there is a glaring risk with one of their medications that they're on, or if it's something that I really don't know, I might say, well, let's wait. Let me take a look into it and I'll let you know. But most of the ones that are mainstream, like I said, are considered relatively low risk. The bad part of it is that, you know, when patients ask me about it, is we don't have a lot of clinical evidence from research to support it. A lot of these are natural supplements that are not very well tested, if tested at all. You know, a lot of them have shown efficacy and safety in a lab or in animal models and either haven't been tested in humans, or if they've been tested in humans, haven't been tested well or consistently. So as physicians, when people ask me about what do I think, we talk about the research that's available. And most of the time I have to say, we don't know. We don't know, but we may know, you know, some information about side effects or, you know, interactions with some of your medications. They can be costly, you know, so, you know, a lot of these supplements and practices are not covered by insurance. Some of them are relatively cheap, but some of them can be expensive. And it's always very important to understand that these are not regulated, or at least not regulated well. Natural products, a lot of them are considered food or supplements, and they're not considered medicine. So the FDA has no obligation to regulate them. Although, you know, government agencies do occasionally kind of look through and make sure that there's some level of safety. But most of the time, you know, things that people are buying on the internet or in a lot of places on the shelves are not regulated. So you don't know if what's listed on the label is actually what you're getting. You don't know if it's pure. You don't know if there's other things in it. Unfortunately, there have been a lot of reports. Some of the large health food companies and large, retailers out there have gotten in trouble over, you know, the last decade selling things that when government agencies go and look into, there is absolutely nothing or very little of what's posted on the label actually in the bottle, and people have been paying for this. There are also studies that have been that have found, you know, impurities in this. There can sometimes be bacteria or fungus, especially in some of the herbal or botanical products. There have been reports of heavy metals, sometimes in low quantities, found in some of these therapies and other contaminants. So again, people have to be very cautious that they're getting it from reputable sources. And there are some things in the label, which I'll talk about at the end, that you can look at to know if it's been vetted. There can also be interaction of some of these natural products with prescription medications and even with each other. So, you know, like anything that you put in your mouth, these products are metabolized by some of the same enzymes that prescription medications and other therapies are metabolized by. So they can alter the metabolism of some of your medications, the important ones being blood thinners, cholesterol medications, antihypertensives, but others as well. So it's very important for people to understand that when you have, you know, are on a lot of prescription medications, especially important ones like that, that you're not taking something over the counter that's going to interfere with the metabolism of some of these prescription medications. And there also can be drug reactions or reactions to some of these therapies. You know, they can have, a lot of side effects, some of them for certain people. They can have side effects for others not. So it is always important to look up and see what's out there in terms of potential side effects and toxicity. It's always important to remember that natural does not necessarily mean safe. So, you know, always make sure that you do your research before you try one of these therapies and talk to your physician so they understand maybe some interaction with your medicines. Then, of course, there's what I call the ugly part of this. You know, whenever you're looking at a multi-million or billion-dollar industry, there is always the potential for fraud and shysters out there looking to take advantage. And this, it's not only in you know, I'm not trying to pump up prescription medicines and put down complementary therapies. This happens also, you know, false advertising, false marketing. Whenever you're looking at big business like this, there is always the potential for things that are marketed inappropriately. And the government tries to keep up with this. And if you go to the FDA website and the Federal Trade Commission, you will find that there are companies on both ends that get warning letters from the FTC about, you know, false advertising and false marketing, and that they can't do that. Unfortunately, companies find ways to get around that. There's certain wording that they can use where they're not quite saying they're curative or neuroprotective. And so they make people believe that, that this is a miracle cure. And I think people have to be careful with that and talk to their physicians. I think any physician or scientist that studies Parkinson's and treats Parkinson's can tell you with definition, we have nothing at this point proven that cures Parkinson's disease or slows down its progression. So anything that you read that looks like a miracle, it's not. There's potential, there's definitely potential, and there's a lot of active research, but as of right now, we don't have anything yet that falls into those two categories. There's also a lot of imbalance in data out there. So it's very important to understand, you know, when you're looking at toxicities of pharmaceuticals, prescription medications, you know, they go through rigorous testing, both for efficacy as well as for safety. And so side effects, toxicities must be recorded and logged in, and they're public access, right? So, you know, you will see for medications, including Tylenol and aspirin and our run-of-the-mill, there are a lot of side effects and toxicities. There are potential. The flip side to that is there's no obligation to report for some of these because they're not prescription, because they're not approved by the FDA, because they're not regulated, there is no obligation to report. And so a lot of companies take advantage of that and they'll be like, oh, look at all the toxicities with your conventional medications and there's nothing reported for these. So there's a real imbalance of data and people have to understand that. Again, just because it's natural doesn't mean it's safe. And, you know, again, there's toxicities on both ends that are possible and people have to be informed consumers, look at what's out there, discuss with your practitioners to understand what are the potential risks and will you follow me to see how I feel, what happens if I do decide to try these. So, you know, why is there this allure? Well, again, there's a lot of things that are going on in the brain of Parkinson's disease that we know of. You know, there are things when you know, scientists go in and take a look at the brains of Parkinson's, both in animals and humans, we know that there are processes like inflammation, there's oxidative stress, our powerhouse cells that produce energy for us, the mitochondria, there's dysfunction of those. Proteins that are innate in our brains structurally change. They become sticky and they form clumps, what we call Lewy bodies in the brains of Parkinson's. We know that there's altered communication between the brain and other parts of the body, specifically the gut and the nervous system parts that have to do with regulation of blood pressure. And there can also be a lot of changes in brain chemicals as well. Some of them are upregulated and can actually cause more toxicity, like glutamate in the brain. And all of these, we think, play a role in causing some of the degenerative process in the cells of Parkinson's disease, leading to a reduction in some brain chemicals, the main one being dopamine, that leads to the physical symptoms of Parkinson's. And that's how Parkinson's disease is manifest. And the allure of complementary therapies is that, you know, some studies in the lab and in animal models have shown that some of these therapies do actually help some of these processes. They reduce inflammation, they may reduce oxidative stress, they may help mitochondria function better. There are some vitamins and supplements and herbs that have been shown to, in animal models and in the lab, maybe prevent the misfolding of some of these proteins or help regulation, communication between the brain and other parts of the body. The problem that we have in understanding is, you know, do these processes, are they the culprits of what's happening in the brain? Or are they byproducts of what something else that's going on in the brain that we just haven't quite captured yet? And I, you know, again, I understand why people gravitate to them, because our traditional medications really just help out at this part. They're trying to supplement some of these brain chemicals that are low or abnormal in our bodies. And we're trying to get people's dopamine levels, serotonin levels, acetylcholine levels up so that people can function better and move better. So why is it so hard, our research in Parkinson's disease? Well, the truth is we just don't know yet what causes Parkinson's disease. As I mentioned, we see all these processes in the brain, but we don't quite understand if, are these processes at play there? Are they the cause of this degeneration that we see in certain cell groups? Or is it that they're byproducts, they're upregulated once this process starts? So we don't quite know. And then how do we fix it? Do we just target one thing, or do we have to target all of them? If we just target inflammation with a product, is that enough to change the course of Parkinson's disease? Or do we have to find products that, you know, affect all of these processes together to really make a difference? We have a lot of animal models that have been around for quite a while, both in rats, mice, and primates, that are good models of what's going on in Parkinson's disease. But those animals are not humans. We're much more complex. And so we see this all the time in clinical trials of pharmaceuticals. Things that look really good in animal models just don't translate to humans. And we see that also in some of the complementary natural products that have been studied that look good in animals, look good in the lab. But then, you know, when they're studied, some of them adequately studied have not panned out in humans. And it may be also too that all humans, we're not alike. You know, we think that there is a lot of individual variability in people, both genetically, what puts them at risk for Parkinson's disease, exposures they've had throughout their lifetime, what is the main symptom we're trying to attack and follow over time. And so those individual differences may also play a role as to why both pharmaceuticals and complementary therapies don't pan out. There's also the possibility that we're not testing this properly, that the biomarkers that we use are too crude. We don't have a good blood test or imaging tool, although we're starting to use, there's some brain imaging tools we're starting to use more, but none of them have been great to follow people very specifically to see if any of these products really do slow down the progression of Parkinson's. You know, from pharmaceutical standpoint, you know, bringing drugs to market, it's a very costly and time-consuming process. And patients always ask me, why does it take so long for scientists to come up with new things for Parkinson's? And the reason is, well, one, it's very expensive to test. And two is it takes a long time because it goes through multiple phases of testing to make sure that these drugs are not toxic, that at least their side effect profile balances out with whatever benefit they might, you know, bring on for patients. So this whole process takes a long time, and it's going to be the same for complementary therapies. And there's limited funding out there, despite the fact that there's billions of dollars available for research funding in Parkinson's disease. You know, there's a lot of research going on from many different areas. And so it's a big competition what gets funded. And natural products, because they're not patentable, because they're considered natural, unfortunately falls down on the lower end of the food chain, sometimes for some of these, for some of this testing and funding, research funding. So the NIH realized this, you know, a couple decades ago. They developed what was called the National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medicine, which was later renamed the National Center for Complementary and Integrative Health. In the last couple of decades, they have been trying to focus some of this research funding for complementary and alternative therapies. They, you know, set up a five-year plan as to what they want to focus on. They vet proposals from scientists, companies, you know, academic centers in regards to some of these complementary therapies. That sound, you know, good sound sort of principles of research, and try to understand and bring out, you know, good evidence-based science about some of these therapies. There is also a patient portal for at this committee, at this organization. So it's an important website if you're interested in these therapies. They have something that's called the Know the Science, and they talk about, you know, how are things vetted both in pharmaceuticals and complementary therapy trials? How do you understand what they mean by some of the terms placebo-controlled, randomized controlled? How do you understand how patient numbers? What does that mean? What's an adequate patient number? The studies, you understand what peer-reviewed. So they try to guide you through some of the terms of research and discussion about some of the newer studies that are coming out. For people that do herbs and botanicals, they actually came out with something a few years back, an app that's called the Herb List that people can have on their phone or a computer. It's still pretty rudimentary, but I use it sometimes, and it has herbs that are commonly used and what they've been studied for, what the evidence is, what are their potential interactions with medications and toxicity. So the NIH website here can be very useful for patients. So let's talk a little bit about the different therapies that are out there. Well, we generally break them down into what we call natural products. These are vitamins and minerals, antioxidants and anti-inflammatory agents, and then plant-derived herbs and botanicals. And then there are mind and body practices. And these can be self-guided. These can be practitioner used, such as the manipulative body and body-based approaches, and then more traditional, what we call energy therapies. And then, of course, there are traditional medical systems or whole medical systems. These are cultural, ancient Chinese or Indian practices that have been around, Native American practices that have been around for millennia, that usually use a combination of a lot of these different therapies. So I'm going to go ahead and talk a little bit about these. And I'm not going to spend too much time on any one product here or go too in-depth, because honestly, I could spend the bulk of today's lecture just kind of going through products and the pluses and minuses. What I can tell you is that there's growing evidence, but we have yet to find a product, whether it's a vitamin, a dietary supplement, an herb or botanical, that we can say with reasonable confidence people should be on it, right? So people ask me questions and always say, honestly, we don't have anything from research standpoint that I can say, you know, confidently, I think you need to be on. If there was, I would be telling everybody to be on it. And some of these have been, you know, properly vetted and come to the conclusion that, you know, we just don't have enough evidence from a human, you know, research standpoint to really promote them. You know, things like coenzyme Q10, creatine, vitamin E, glutathione, these have been, you know, properly studied thus far. And as of yet, we have not been able to have a consensus that they are, you know, protective or curative or really give adequate benefit to most people with Parkinson's disease. Having said that, I have plenty of patients that have tried these and feel that symptomatically they do feel benefit. They tend to be, as I mentioned, relatively low risk as long as people are sticking within modest doses and they're not getting, you know, they're getting them from reputable sources. Sometimes they can give benefit to some people. Glutathione is one that people always talk to me about. And it's important to know that it's available in multiple different formulations. I usually tell people, don't spend a lot of money on oral glutathione. It gets metabolized or gets broken down in the stomach with acidic sort of enzymes, and it really gets poorly absorbed. Intravenous has shown some efficacy, but it's very short-lived. It's very costly. So you have to keep going back to keep the benefit from it. And it can have some side effects, dizziness, headache. Some people do get a little short of breath with infusions, can have, you know, some mental fogginess or insomnia with it. Interestingly, intranasal is one that has shown some benefit and has been shown to get into the brains of people. But again, when more adequately studied, we haven't yet been able to come out with reasonable security that it's something that everybody should be on. And there's been a number of other things, and this is by no means an exhaustive list of, you know, things that people have been interested in or have been studied, you know, everything from omega-3 fatty acids to choline to resveratrol, vitamin B, vitamin C, vitamin D3, all of them have been studied to some degree, whether in animal studies or human studies. And as of yet, we don't have reasonable evidence to sort of promote it for everybody. It is also important, and I highlight it here, to know that some of these medications do interact with blood thinners, with aspirin, with Plavix, with blood pressure medications. They can cause, you know, problems with low blood pressure. They can cause gastrointestinal side effects. They can cause headaches. So it is always important that people read up about these and understand the interaction they may have with your medications or with each other. Herbs and botanicals, again, these have received a lot of interest over the last couple of decades, and I have patients that take them, anything from ginkgo biloba to curcumin, ginseng, which in this country tends to be more Asian ginseng, camellia sinensis, which, you know, is the plant from which green, black, and oolong teas come from, lion's mane, milk thistle is one that's very popular these days because people believe that it might help in liver and gallbladder issues. So there's a lot of these herbs and botanicals that people have a lot of interest in. And it is important. And again, none of them have been properly studied, especially in Parkinson's disease. There are small trials with ginseng and ginkgo biloba, curcumin, milk thistle, you know, so it is important to understand that, you know, the problems with a lot of these studies is that people use different sources, different formulations, different doses. Some of these studies don't have placebo groups, so we don't know if it's a real effect or a placebo effect. So it makes it hard for us as physicians to recommend it when we don't really know if it truly helps. And again, you know, always make sure that you understand what some of the potential side effects and risks can be with some of these products. Mucuna is something that's received a lot of interest, and I have a lot of questions over the years about Mucuna purens, also known as the velvet bean. This is actually a legume, an edible legume that's found in tropical and subtropical areas, specifically the desert plains of Southeast Asia. The seeds of this legume contain levodopa. Levodopa is what's in cinnamet. It is the precursor that your body takes up levodopa and turns it into dopamine in the brain. and the seeds of mucuna do contain levodopa. And it can vary depending on the plant itself, anywhere from, you know, the reports from 3% to 10% of levodopa. In Indian and Asian countries, they boil this legume. They may take out the seeds and eat them. We in this country usually recommend that people don't eat it. It definitely has to be boiled, roasted, cooked. But in most cases, it is the seeds are taken out, they're cooked, they're ground, and it's in a powder and measured out by weight to understand how much mucuna people are getting it. And there is some evidence. It's, you know, there have been some decent studies that have looked at mucuna and compared it to traditional cinnamon, carbidopa, levodopa. And honestly, these studies have shown that mucuna may actually have a faster onset than traditional cinnamon, maybe a little bit more of a stable effect, may even last longer than regular cinnamon, similar in its efficacy for relief of motor symptoms without worsening dyskinesias. So there is something to it. And some of the studies have shown that mucuna may actually have a good effect compared to traditional levodopa. The problem is that from a long-term perspective, we just don't know. And there have been some longer studies looking at mucuna where, you know, as patients are on for longer periods of time, months, you know, the initial ones were just single dose studies, and then studies where people were kept on mucuna versus levodopa cinnamon, about half of the patients on mucuna would discontinue it because of either side effects, most of them being gastrointestinal, or who had worsening function over time. And so it's always very important to understand, you know, about mucuna, that we just still don't know. There is some evidence that it may be a good therapy. And I know that in countries, you know, in Asia, it's used a lot more. And there's actually interesting research in countries where, you know, they're very poor and there isn't access to some of the medications that we have here are starting to use or have been using mucuna more as a treatment of Parkinson's than we do here. And we don't have a lot of data about that, unfortunately. But long-term from mucuna, we know that when you're on cinnamon, things change over time. We need to adjust the dose and we can regulate specifically how much levodopa that you're getting over time. With mucuna, we just don't know how to titrate it over time. And, you know, mucuna is not paired with carbidopa. When we give you levodopa, it's paired with carbidopa, which blocks out some of the side effects like nausea, bloating, dizziness. With mucuna, you know, there isn't that. And so as people start increasing the dose or even from the beginning, they can have these side effects. There are some interesting early studies looking at pairing mucuna with carbidopa that look promising, but we're just not there yet as to whether this from a long-term perspective. You know, high doses, as I mentioned, can be also associated with some of the same toxicities that you can get with traditional levodopa, headache, confusion, hallucinations, dyskinesias. Again, mucuna, like a lot of natural products, is not regulated for content or impurities. There have been reports of, you know, mucuna powders or mucuna, you know, bottles that are contain fungi that contain heavy metals. So you have to be very careful. I usually recommend if you're going to do this that you work with a licensed naturopath, somebody who sort of understands and sources this properly. And this is a legume that has been studied and used in other cultures because it's thought to have some other properties, may help in diabetic control, may help as an antidepressant, can lower blood pressure. So if you're on medications that are treating these things, you know, this can interact with those medications, lower your blood pressure, lower your diabetes, and it may be that, you know, you could have side effects. So always important to understand that. Cannabinoids is another area that has gotten a lot of interest and a lot of conversations in clinic regarding cannabinoids. Now, cannabinoids are one of hundreds of substances that are found in the cannabis sativa plant. And there's more than 100 cannabinoids that are known. The main cannabinoids that have been looked at for medical practice are THC or tetrahydrocannabinol, cannabidiol or CBD, and then there's a couple of other ones that are gaining interest, cannabinol, CBN, cannabigerol, CBG, and cannabidiol, CBDL. And these are growing in interest. THC is the one that is regulated, is considered a Schedule One drug. And so it is not available because it produces euphoric effects in a certain percentage or a certain dose, can produce euphoric effects. Cannabidiol is legal, and it's legal in all 50 states. Products of hemp and cannabidiol or CBD that have less than 0.3% of THC are legal in all 50 states. Cannabidiol or CBD has got more calming effect. It's not euphoric. It's thought to maybe have anti-inflammatory effects as well. And, you know, medical marijuana, which takes in the whole plant that has both cannabinoids and CBD, is only approved for medical uses in, you know, about half the states, I think about 30 states. California being one of the states where Parkinson's disease is considered a medical use for medical marijuana. But with, you know, prescription from a physician or practitioner that is licensed to do so, there are some FDA approved uses. There is a purified form of CBD that is approved for Dravet syndrome, which is a rare seizure disorder in children. There are edibles, dronabinol and nabilone, that are synthetic forms of THC that are approved for nausea, vomiting, weight loss of cancer and HIV and AIDS. And in Europe, they have what's called Sativex, which is a combination THC-CBD, which is being used for overactive bladder and spasticity in multiple sclerosis patients, and also used for neuropathic pain. In this country, unfortunately, the testing of cannabinoids has been very restricted, but there have been some small studies that have shown some benefit in things like anxiety, depression, neuropathic pain, may help with sleep, may help also neuropathic pain, as I mentioned. But again, it's very early, and the studies with this have been all over the place. Such is the case also in the research of CBD with Parkinson's disease. There hasn't been a great amount of studies looking at cannabinoids in Parkinson's disease. There are a few that are decently studied, but they've been kind of all over the place in the sense of the products that are being used, the dosing that's being used, whether or not they're using a placebo group or not to see if it really works, and may have shown some benefit in maybe dyskinesias, maybe if there's pain associated from rigidity or spasticity. But, you know, some of them have actually negated that. So we still don't know. The conversation always when patients ask me about CBD and cannabinoids is, you know, I try to tell them a little bit about the literature that's out there. It hasn't been really real studied. You know, some of the studies have shown, or they're looking at, you know, improvement in sleep, maybe the improvement in anxiety, maybe the improvement in pain. But the honest truth is that we don't know, and there can be some toxicities. We always tell people to try to avoid smoking or vaping. There's combustible products and smoking, you know, products. And so, you know, puts you at risk for lung diseases. And there have been reports of serious lung injury from people vaping cannabinoids, especially THC containing products. So people have to be very careful. If people are using edibles, there can be a real risk. So these edibles sit in your intestine for a while. They, you know, are slowly absorbed. The effect can take a long time. And if you have constipation, these products can sit in the intestines for a while and all of a sudden hit you. And, you know, or sometimes people are waiting, it's not doing anything. And all of a sudden, you know, they're in sort of a toxic level. So if people are using edibles, they have to be very careful and understand that there can be a delayed effect from those products. These products are also metabolized by the liver. So it's very important to understand that they can interact with blood thinners and other prescription products that use the same enzymes. And they can cause symptoms of low blood pressure, fatigue, dizziness, mood, or changes in balance if there's sedation. You know, some people even with CBD can have hallucinations, changes in appetite and weight. And again, like all natural products, there is a problem with quality control. It's getting better, but there's poor still regulation on quality and proper labeling of some of these products. So I always tell patients to make sure that they're sourcing it from reputable sources. The Parkinson's Foundation came out with a consensus statement in 2020 that talked a little bit about some of the research that's out there, some of the different products that are available, and some of the things that people have to be careful about. So it's an interesting one for everybody to read if you're interested in these products. There are some supplements that I do use. Again, some of them have some evidence, but I consider them relatively safe. I use a lot of melatonin for sleep and some of the REM sleep behavior issues. Chamomile, either in tea or in extract, can help with sleep and anxiety, as can valerian root and passion flower. Valerian root in some people can cause some problems, so we have to be careful sometimes. Ginger and peppermint oil can sometimes help for gastrointestinal issues. Flaxseed oil contains fiber, may help with constipation. And cranberry extract can sometimes help with if people have a risk of recurrent urinary tract infections. They can sometimes help with that. But always important that if you're taking these before you take them, discuss them with your doctor, both your specialist and your primary care doctor, so they're aware of what supplements you're taking. Now I'm going to pivot over, because I see I'm running out of time as always, to mind and body practices. And this is an area that I find really fascinating, actually. And I talk to my patients a lot about this. So mind and body practices are practices where people use their attention, their breathing, they try to focus on their inner self. They try to focus on their body movement, their posture, and try to relieve negative thoughts. It's easy to learn, easy to practice most of these. And there's a lot of both free apps, there's a lot of YouTube videos, but there's also practitioners out there that can guide you through these. And some of these have shown some growing evidence that they can be useful in Parkinson's disease. And also as we get older, just as part of our aging, can help with a lot of things. So, you know, some studies have shown that it may help reduce stress, anxiety, may help improve concentration and memory, may help improve sleep, and also sometimes maybe help a little bit with motor symptoms. Yoga can sometimes be used for flexibility, stress relief, relaxation. And there is modest evidence. There have been studies looking at yoga and Parkinson's. There is modest evidence that it may help improve mobility, balance, strength, and flexibility, can help reduce anxiety and improve quality of life. So you know, I talk to my patients about these. They're relatively low risk. There are yoga, gentle yoga practices out there that people can find. Can be done in seated positions. So even if you have problems with your gait and balance, these can be done in seated positions and can help people have a sense of calm, relief, sense of focus. Deep breathing, biofeedback, guided imagery. These are other types of tools that are being looked at and some people use, again, to help focus inward, help focus on your body, relax muscles, improve your posture, release anxiety and stress. So I find these can be very useful for a lot of patients. And like I mentioned, can be free and easy to learn. Tai Chi and Qigong are two practices also that have received a lot of attention. They're similar, but they're not the same. Qigong has been around for centuries, and it's a medical practice that's practiced a lot in Asia, where people focus, use their breath and use their body movement and their posture to focus on inward. They're generally gentle and safe. Qigong comes in both a dynamic form where there's actually movement of the limbs, but it can also come in a meditative form where people are just seated and holding a posture with their arms and taking slow, deep breaths. And Tai Chi is actually considered a martial art. It's actually a little more aggressive, a little bit more complex. It really needs to be learned. But both of these have had some studies done in Parkinson's disease and have been shown to, both in Parkinson's disease and in general health. In Parkinson's disease, some evidence that they may improve movement, they may improve walking ability and balance, but in general have been shown to maybe reduce pain. The American College of Rheumatology actually looks at Tai Chi as part of a structured therapy plan in people that have arthritic pain, especially joint pains, may also help lung function and respiratory endurance, may help as part of a plan to reduce blood pressure, reduce anxiety, improve sleep and memory. And generally, studies have shown that it may help improve quality of life as we get older. Then we look at manipulative and body-based practices. This is usually with the help of a practitioner. There are osteopathic processes, what we call therapies, what we call craniosacral therapy. This is where practitioners gently touch, stretch, put pressure on certain parts, top of the, you know, bottom of the skull, low back, to help relieve pressure and pain, stretch. Some evidence that it may be useful for neuropathic pain and chronic low back pain. Massage, again, you know, intuitively might help reduce tension, muscle tension, both in the neck and the back, may help circulation. And as long as it's not done too aggressively, where it puts people at sort of increased muscle injury, can help relieve some muscle tension. There's vibrational therapy, either whole vibration where people stand on these platforms or localized into the muscle. It causes muscle contractions, little muscle contractions. And, you know, in the short term in Parkinson's disease, it's shown that it may help with some leg strength, may help slightly, and in the short term, relieve muscle rigidity or pain. And so some physical therapy groups sometimes use it as part of their practice, you know, in helping relieve some of these symptoms. Manipulative and mind-body practices, another one. I enjoy this one. I've practiced this one. Alexander technique, again, it's with the practitioner. The practitioner teaches people how to be aware of their body alignment and posture to help reduce muscle tension, to help increase range of motion. And it's interesting to understand how we hold our posture sometimes really makes it easier on how we take a deep breath, how easily we can expel our voice. And there have been a few studies in Parkinson's, the disease, that have shown some improved measures of disability, and even in mood, some improvement in depression, anxiety with some of these techniques. But again, usually these are not covered under insurance. Energy therapies, these are more traditional therapies used a lot in Asian cultures. This idea that in our body, we have energy flows through meridians, and we try to balance these with the environment, and that disease and medical conditions come about when there's improper flow or blockages in these energies. And there's acupuncture, which actually has shown some evidence in animal models of being helpful. I'm not sure that we can explain that. But in humans, it's had kind of mixed results. Even when we've studied it with sham procedures, needles that feel like acupuncture needles but don't puncture the skin, we find that there can be a huge placebo response in that. So actually, the American Academy of Neurology and the Movement Disorder Society a couple of years back looked at all the available research on acupuncture, and it was just all over the place. The pressure points that were being used, the types of needles, whether there was a placebo group or not, and they weren't able to come out with a consensus whether it was beneficial or not. And then, of course, as I mentioned, there are traditional medical systems that are been in existence for millennia, both in the Chinese culture, Asian cultures, and in Ayurvedic medicine in India, that use a combination of both natural products and some of these mind-body practices together, along with conventional therapies most of the time to help in medical conditions. In this country, Native Americans also have their own medical system that tries to balance both spiritually, physically, emotionally, that includes prayer, healing touch, herbs and supplements, as well as other rituals to help heal people. So some key points from today's talk, you know, complementary therapies are defined as natural products and practices that are not the conventional medicine. They're not by prescription, but that are can be taken alongside conventional medicines in the treatment of conditions, separate from alternative therapies where, you know, we never recommend that people forego therapy if they need it for some of these. But, you know, sometimes can be used in early Parkinson's and early conditions if people are not yet at that point where they need medicines. Always very important to discuss with their doctors. And it's not to say that there isn't promise in them. There's a lot of promising data building both in the lab as well as in animal models with some of these therapies. But as practicing physicians and scientists, we just don't have a lot of backing yet to wholly recommend a lot of these across the board. In general, most of them are relatively safe if you understand what they're for, understand what interaction they may have with medicines that you're taking, understanding toxicity and having an open discussion with your doctor. I think most of us will kind of go along, but it's always important to understand the natural does not mean safe. They can have their side effects, they can have their toxicities, they can interact with medications that you're on. And unfortunately, a lot of them are not regulated, so you have to source them properly. So what can you do? Well, first of all, be careful. There is no miracle cure or anything yet that is known to slow down the progression of Parkinson's. So be careful and do your research. Talk to your providers about anything that you're going to be taking. Do one therapy at a time, whether it's going to be complementary or it's going to be conventional medicine. My saying is always, too many recipes thrown into the pot. Something goes wrong and you don't know what it is. So you always have to do one thing at a time and read about it, be an informed consumer. There are independent sort of entities where you can go and look. Always look at the back of labels for natural products. There's three organizations that I've been trying to vet natural products. There's the US Pharmacopeia. And so if you see an USP label on it, it usually means on the label, it means that it's been vetted for proper labeling and for safe, for purity. Consumer Labs is a nonprofit also that's been trying to vet some of these natural products. And the NSF International is an international group that's been trying internationally to keep some regulation over some of these products. And here are some of the useful resources that people can look at to learn a little bit more. So I'm going to stop there. I'm sorry, I went right to the hour, but if anybody has any questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Diaz. That was such a wonderful talk. I definitely think this is one of those that I would definitely recommend to our patients. I think this really opens the conversation. I think the bottom line is if there are complementary supplements or therapies that you are considering or looking into, to definitely do your due diligence and read about them and read the research behind them, and also have a conversation with your healthcare provider, as some of them may have interactions, drug interactions with your PD medications, but definitely some of them too that you can do safely, like yoga and meditation practices. Mm-hmm. So those we highly recommend. I know we run out of time. You kind of talked already about Mekuna. There was, I wasn't sure if you wanted to go, with specifics as that can be, but I beg, I'll leave it to you.
Yeah, no, I just saw that there was one question there that was posed. I talked a little bit about Mekuna. Plasmalogens, I don't really, honestly, I don't know too much about it, but now I'm going to go look it up. NADH, again, NADH is a natural chemical. We make it NADH. It's part of our, some of our natural metabolic cycles. I don't know that there's good quality research, and it's always important to understand that, some of these things that we talk about, right? If you look at the research, and I'll give you glutathione as an example, right? Glutathione is a natural chemical. We make glutathione. And it's known that as we age, glutathione levels decrease. And we know that in the brains of Parkinson's disease, it's been found that even compared to normal aging, glutathione levels are low. So then, of course, people look at that research and go, I got to supplement glutathione. But it's always important to understand that, what you take in by mouth is not always the same as what your own body makes. And so just because studies have shown that, these things are altered in the brains or in the body, doesn't necessarily mean that supplementation is going to get at it, right? So you always have to be careful with that. you know, some of these, as I mentioned, so you really need to do some research because, you know, so, and there's different resources that are available. You know, they can have their side effects, right? So you have to be careful with that. Yeah, I mean, again, we don't know yet what slows down progression. Nothing that's proven yet. I'll tell you from my experience, and I always say that, you know, my patients know I'm always, and Giselle was right, this opens the door to conversation. People should feel comfortable. We're, as physicians and practitioners, you know, advanced care practitioners, we're not here to dictate. We're here to have a conversation with you, be your advisors. If you have questions about things that you read, about products that you have questions about, want to try, it should be a conversation with us. And I think most of us, I know everybody on our team, but I think most practitioners these days are willing to have a conversation. And always keep in mind that, you know, nothing substitutes a healthy lifestyle. People should be exercising. People should be trying to eat right, trying to stick to what's called a Mediterranean diet or a Mind diet. These are things that, you know, are showing some evidence. And, you know, sitting on the couch and leading a sedentary lifestyle, but then trying to take these supplements is not a way to go. And so, you know, there's a lot of things that people can do, having conversations, making sure that you're taking just enough medicine to keep you moving, to keep you doing things that you need to do, doing your part, eating well, sleeping well, reducing stress, exercising. And if you want to add some of these complementary therapies, again, it's a discussion. Like I said, most of them are relatively low risk, but just to understand some of the side effects and toxicities. VR, I'm assuming, virtual reality. Yeah, that's an interesting question because that's been a question for a while. And there's been some, you know, growing evidence about what we call exer gaming, right? And in fact, there's people within our P&I group that are looking at this. And if that's something that you're interested in, you may want to, we don't do it at the Torrance group, but the Santa Monica group, as part of the brain health, they've been looking at some of this, what we call exer gaming or virtual reality, where you're put into environments where you have to, you know, change or shift your motor abilities and also get thrown in some cognitive tasks. So yeah, there is growing evidence on that it may help mobility and even may help memory and thinking. We don't know how long the effect lasts, if it's something or what's the right type of gaming technique. So this is an active area of research right now.
Okay, we've definitely gone over our time. Thank you so much, Dr. Diaz, for extending a little bit. And thank you everyone for staying. But definitely if you need to watch or re-watch our videos, they are available on our website. So once again, thank you so much, Dr. Diaz. Definitely a conversation starter for our patients. I hope you learned a lot today and we will see you back next month with Dr. Petrosian discussing mental health about Parkinson's. So see you next month. Thank you so much for being here today. Have a wonderful rest of your week. Take care. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.